presence there.
Amen. 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 I'm going to introduce our speakers. Our first speaker is going to be Reverend Juan Bullock, Director of Evangelism for the Southeastern District, South Florida Conference, and the Amen Zion Church. Forgiveness, for they know not what they do. Our second speaker is going to be Reverend King Baker, Associate Minister of Ministry of Mount Sinai, Shiloh Missionary Baptist Church, Kissimmee, Florida. He will share with us today, Shall Thou Be With Me in Paradise. Our third speaker will be the Reverend Willie Bell Smith, Associate Minister of St. Mark AME Church, Orlando, Florida. She will share with us, Woman, Behold Thy Son. Our fourth speaker will be the presiding elder, Rochelle Pearson, the pastor of Cornish Memorial Amy Zion Church in Key West, Florida. She will share, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? Our fifth speaker is Reverend Latanya Floyd, pastor of Bethel AME Church, Kissimmee, Florida. He will share, I thirst. Our sixth speaker is the Reverend Elijah Knight, pastor of St. Mark Amy Zion Church, Pensacola, Florida. He will share, it is finished. And our last speaker is the Reverend Ralph Williamson, Associate Minister of Macedonia Missionary Church, Kissimmee, Florida. He will share, Father, into thine hands I commend my spirit. Amen. Amen. Reverend Ron Bullock, please.
Good morning, everyone.
Morning.
I am, my heart is so heavy. My son-in-law is dying from pneumonia right now, and my daughter. It's just so hard to believe, but anyway, we want to talk about Father, forgive them, and the subject we're going to be talking about today is the abundance of the heart. Words we never forget. And our scripture is from Matthew 12, 34. For out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh. I want us to look at some of the last words that Jesus Christ ever uttered on earth from the cross, from where he died. And these are the final words that Jesus Christ spoke while hanging on the cross. On the cross, we see our Lord's greatest works. And on that cross, we hear the Lord's greatest words. But yesterday, I was reading from the Reader's Digest. I like that book, and I like to read some of the stories. But one of the stories that caught my eye was words that we never forget. Words that mean a lot. And so I was reading about this woman in Kansas City who had died, and she had written these words on her tombstones. I told you I was sick. See, some words live on. And then another story in there where it talked about a man who owned a restaurant for years, and he was dying on his bed, and while he's dying on his bed, he wanted to say something to his family. So his family leaned down to hear his final words. And he said, slice the ham thin. And then they say he died. Some words live on. And then I read about a wealthy man who had died, and his family gathered together to hear the reading of his last will and testament. and his attorney read, he read, I said, I, Sam Jones, of having a large fortune, being of sound mind and proper judgment, want to reveal to my family that I spent it all. Some words live on. However, if there were any words that live on, it would be the final words of Jesus Christ. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. They know not what they do. You see, Jesus clearly saw that sin and Satan had a powerfully blinding effect on sinners. And they were so ignorant of the fact that they were crucifying innocents. Matter of fact, Pilate said, I find him no fault at all. Herod said, nothing worthy of him is done of him. Judas said, for I have betrayed it. So why were they so ignorant of the cross? They didn't know that they were crucifying the Lord of glory, because Jesus was so different from what they had hoped for in the Messiah. They weren't aware of their awful criminality. As the Lord hung on the cross, he recognized the blinding power of Satan and sin. But they were ignorant of the purpose of the cross. And it's through the Son of God on the cross that forgiveness is available, in whom we have redemption through him, even the forgiveness of sins. It is because of Christ's atoning sacrifice on the cross that it is said, without the shedding of blood, there is no remission. Satan still blinds men today. The devil blinds men to the guilt of their soul. We all think we're good. Think of it. A good sinner, a good lawbreaker. That's contradiction of the term. Oh, how the devil blinds men to the guilt of their soul. He tells them that they aren't that bad. He blinds men to the gift of the Savior. You know, I read another story in Reader's Digest, and it talked about this bar. And the bar was called the Gates of Hell. And right down the street, there was a church called Calvary Church. And it said that one night that this drunk man stopped this young man coming out of the church and said, can you tell me where the Gates of Hell is located? The young man pointed down the street and he said, in a corner. In the corner is the Gates of Hell. You go right past Calvary's church. Just go right past Calvary and you will come to the Gates of Hell. How true was that statement? The cross of Calvary stands between every man and hell. Yes. If you travel past Jesus, you will land in hell. Blessed are those whose iniquities are forgiven and whose sins are covered. Ignorance is not innocent. Sin needs forgiveness. If ignorance excuses guilt, it needed no forgiveness. Forgiveness is what the cross is all about. Forgiveness is not cheap. It's very expensive, and it cost Jesus Christ his life. Forgiveness was the purpose of him. On the cross, we find forgiveness. And praying for forgiveness for his enemies, Christ struck right down to the root of their need. Their need is our need as well. Jesus prayed not for their wealth. He didn't pray for prosperity of the nation. Jesus prayed for their forgiveness. He recognized their deepest needs. When Jesus said, Father, forgive them, he was saying, and condemn me. Only by his assuming their debt could he plead for their forgiveness. Jesus knew that forgiveness was only possible if he took their sin. Man needs forgiveness for his sins, whether those sins were committed knowingly or unknowingly. And forgiveness must be preceded by a sacrifice. Luke 24, 46 and 47 says that thus it is written, that thus it behooved Christ to suffer and to use from the third day. And what repentance and remission of sins should be preached in his name among all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. Saints, I tell you, as I close, remember when Jesus prayed, Father, forgive them. When man had done his worst, he prayed, Father, forgive them. When the wicked hands and the creature had dared to crucify the Lord of glory, he prayed, Father, forgive them. When Samson came to his dying hours, Jesus prayed, Father, forgive them. When man had done his worst, Christ, he prayed, Father, forgive them. When with wicked hands, the creatures that had dared to crucify the Lord of glory, he prayed, Father, forgive them. When Stephen failed to follow completely the example set by Jesus Christ, Stephen's first thought was of himself. And then he prayed for his enemies, and they stoned Stephen, calling upon God and saying, Lord, receive my spirit. And he kneeled down and cried with a loud voice, Lord, lay not this sin on their charge. But with Christ, the order was reversed. He prayed first for his foes and last for himself. In all things, he has the preeminence. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. God bless you. God keep you. God bless each and every church and congregation. In Jesus' name do we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Great Reverend King. Go ahead, Reverend King.
Hello, can anybody hear me?
Yes.
Okay, I'm sorry, I don't know what happened. I lost you guys. I can't see anybody right now, but if y'all can see or hear me, then I'll start.
Yes, we can see you.
Okay. All right, we want to talk about today, thou shalt be with me in paradise. I think that was the one, and we want to look from Luke chapter, forgive me, I just had so much going on. But anyway, Luke chapter 23, verse 39, okay? And as Jesus was hanging on the cross, okay? And I'm going to read you a few verses here, and then I'm going to talk a little bit about it. And, he says, and one of the malefactors which hanged railed on him, saying, if thou be the Christ, save thyself and us. And the other answered and rebuked him, saying, does thou not fear God, seeing that thou art in the same condemnation? For we receive due reward of our deed, but this man has done nothing amiss. And he said unto Jesus, Lord, remember me when thou comest into thy kingdom. And Jesus said unto him, verily I say unto thee, thou shalt be with me in paradise. And I just want to talk about this morning from there. I just want to talk about, or this afternoon, I just want to talk about that text. And I just want to mention as a subject, justice meets mercy, or judgment meets mercy. Here in this text this morning, we have two men who were hanging beside Jesus. And we got two men in two in the same situation, all three men were on the cross. All three men were on the cross, Jesus and the two malefactors. And the thing that we want to say about this is that they had been before the judge, and they had been before the earthly judge, and the judge had pronounced them all guilty. You know, and when we all stand before God, we stand guilty. So both of these men that were on both sides of Christ were in a predicament. They represent you and I. We were guilty. But Christ was the man in the middle. And what didn't understand, these two men had the same situation, but they looked at it from two different perspectives. When you look at the first man, he looked at Jesus and he said in a sarcastic way, "You claim to be the Christ. And if you are the Christ, then why don't you save me? And why don't you save us and take us back to you?" So his perspective was not from a godly perspective. His perspective was from an ungodly perspective and a selfish perspective. He said, "Lord, I want you to save me." But he wanted God to save him, but he didn't want to do anything that God that was required to do. You understand? So he looked at Jesus and said, if you are who you say you are, then why don't you just save me? And you know, see, both of these men had been judged and they were guilty. And Christ was judged and he was guilty. But what they didn't understand was one man saw his situation as bleak and over because death had been pronounced. And that what I want you to understand, when we look at this, really, we all stand in that same situation. When we stand before God, we all stand guilty, and death is the only option for us. Just as the man that, you know, I think this was the man on the left. He looked at him and said, "Lord, you understand? I'm in a dire situation. I'm dying right now, okay? But before I die, I want to tell you what I got on my mind. You understand? You ain't able to do you. If you were so much, then why can't you save me?" He railed on Jesus, which the word there means blaspheme. He blasphemed the name of God. And he said, "If you're so good, why don't you save me? And why don't you take me to heaven with you?" But the other guy looked at him and said, "Don't you understand?" See what he understood was, see, the one guy felt like, well, the judge done pronounced my sentence, and I'm sentenced to death. And that was the end of the story for him. But the other fellow looked at Jesus, and he saw something different in Christ. He said, "Now man has judged me, but this is the ultimate judge. Christ is the ultimate judge." And this fellow looked at Christ and said, he came from a different perspective. And his perspective was that I'm going to throw myself on the mercy of the court. I'm going to throw myself on the mercy of the judge. And he looked at the judge, who is Jesus, who is really able to do something about his situation. And he understood that. And he said, "Lord, when you enter into your kingdom, Lord, I want you," you understand? He said, "Lord," he rebuked the other fellow and say, "Don't you understand that this man dying between us is not just an ordinary man, but this man is able to change our perspective. He's able to change us. He's able to change where we're going. You understand? He's the only man that's able to determine whether I go up or whether I go down." He said, "This man is able to determine whether I go to heaven or go to hell." So there were two different men, but there was two different perspectives. One saw salvation and one saw death. You understand? And when the first man represent our old man, all that was in the old man was death. But the second man represents the new man, which can turn eternal life. So this man looked to Jesus and he said, "Lord, I know you're a master. I know you're Christ. I know you're good. I know you got it. So Lord, when you enter into your kingdom, Lord, I want you to remember me." And I think, you know, Jesus, he was dying on the cross. And one thing about it, Christ is always there if we call for him. He's there. You understand? This is the only event of the seven sins on the cross and where Christ stopped dying. He stopped dying for a moment. And he looked at the man and said, "Today, you shall be with me in paradise." Isn't that something? That's something to rejoice about. That God said, "Today, not tomorrow. And look at it, he didn't say go down and join St. James, go down and join Shiloh, and then you can come. But he said, today you shall be with me in paradise. And you know what? I think Jesus, from that point on, took this man. And when he went back to heaven, I believe that when he got back, Jesus was on his way back to heaven. And I think the host of the angels were looking at him coming home. And they say, here come Jesus. But you know what? Somebody looked, and I heard an old preacher say once that somebody looked and say, here come Jesus, but he's not coming by himself. He's got somebody with him. And somebody looked and said, well, he's on his way home, but who is that riding with? Who is that coming with him? Is that Abraham, or is that Isaac, or is that Jacob? You understand? But in my mind's eye, somebody said, well, I never seen that fella. But anyway, when he got to heaven, they looked and they saw that it was the thief on the cross. It was the fella that was on his way to hell. I stopped by to tell you, don't care where you are, God is able to save you. He's able to save you. And he brought salvation to this man. So because this man pleaded to God and said, today, you understand? He said, Lord, look home. Lord, I'm in a dire situation. There was two men in two situations, but one came out, one went to hell and one went to heaven. And the reason that he went to heaven is because he trusted Christ. And you know what? That thief on the cross is just like the rest of us. Amen. You understand? He's not going to be any different from the rest. He never got a chance to sing in the choir. He never got a chance to go to the church service. But I guarantee you, when we get to heaven, he'll be right there, because Jesus said, today you shall be with me in paradise. Isn't that a wonderful thing? To be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. I'll stop by to tell you, don't care where you are, we all stand guilty before God. But I want you to understand, justice is what the other man had. He had judgment. Justice said that you should die. But this man right here got mercy. Mercy said, no, oh no, I've already paid the price. And I stop by to tell you, that's what Jesus said to this young man, is that I've paid the price. And I'm going to have mercy on you. And you throw yourself on the mercy of the court. So now you shall not die, but you're going to live. And thanks be to God. He gave him eternal life. Amen.
Amen.
So today you shall be with me in paradise. Amen. Amen. We're in Christ. We shall be with him in paradise. Amen. Amen.
Pastor. Reverend Willie Bell Smith.
Well, yeah.
Reverend Smith.
I don't know what happened. There it
is. I'm here.
Amen. Go ahead, please. Amen.
Good afternoon to everyone. It's good to be in the number one more time. I give honor to God, who is our Father, Christ, who is our Redeemer, the Holy Spirit, who is our Comforter. We give honor to Presiding Elder Jones and his lovely wife, and to everyone that goes to make up this august body today. To all gathered and scattered, but yet we are still connected. Mine is the third one, woman, behold thy son. St. John chapter 19. I'm going to read two verses. St. John 19 and 25 said, now there stood by the cross of Jesus his mother and his mother's sister Mary, the wife of Cleophas, and Mary Magdalene. Verse 26 said, when Jesus therefore saw his mother and the disciples standing by whom he loved, he said unto his mother, woman, behold thy son. And for a short 7 minutes, I'm going to speak on an unforgettable act of love. An unforgettable act of love. God be praised for the majesty of the moment today as we gather on this technology to lift up the name of Jesus on what we call Good Friday. Have you ever wondered what crossed Mary's mind as she stands there at the foot of the cross, her son dying, her firstborn hanging from the cross? It was not a beautiful sight. Don't ever think Good Friday was a beautiful sight at that cross. Mary must have wanted to comfort her son, but she couldn't. There was agony. There was blood dripping down his battered body. The same child that she saw grow from an infant was being crucified. Her child had never done any wrong. Joseph was not there at the time. He was not at the cross. Some of the theologians said Joseph had already died. Even Jesus' other siblings, they were not at the cross. But God always has someone to stand by you. Instead, Mary is surrounded by a small family and some friends. And when Jesus therefore saw her, that is my first point today. He saw his mother. There are some today that don't even take time to see their mother. And there he is hanging on the cross, took time to look and see his mom. I know we are living in the virus and it's keeping us from seeing our mother, and some of us, our mothers is already in heaven. But before the pandemic, if you are listening to me today, when was the last time you saw your mother? This is for those that have a mother that's living. Not only did he see his mother, the Bible said that he spoke to his mom. Jesus didn't call out Mary by name, but he didn't mean no disrespect. That was the custom of that day. And I can imagine he didn't want the mob to know that this was his mother. Have you spoke with your mom recently? I can hear some saying today, I don't have anything to do with my mother. In Jesus' last act of love for family and friends and for his mother, he took the time to see that his mother would be cared for. Not only that, he loved his friend. He loved John, and John loved Jesus. Do you love him today? I know you asked the question, wonder, why didn't Jesus assign the task to his brothers? That's their mom too. I'm glad you asked. As the oldest son, Jesus entrusted his mother to a person who stuck by him. Somebody that stayed with him, even at the cross. If you don't get nothing else out of this message, remember this. Jesus is more impressed with availability than ability. Jesus is more impressed with availability than our ability. John was available. He was right there at the cross. And another thing about John, he realized that he was loved. And those who realize that they are loved are able to love much more. Because to whom much is given, much is required. Woman, behold thy son. Jesus gives us a preview into the nature of the church as family. Jesus tells his dear mom that, in so many words, he's showing her that I'm going to be going away. But I'm not going to leave you comfortless this time. And never leave you comfortless. I'm going to give you another son. And as I read that, that speaks of adoption. Not the bloodline, but because of Jesus. Jesus loved John because John was the one that leaned on his bosom. And the closer that Jesus marched to Calvary, the fewer the disciples became. Is anybody familiar with that today? When things get thick in your life, it seemed like others would thin out. Jesus is the one that gave John and his brothers, James, the nickname Sons of Thunder. Being aware of God's love is a great motivation for change. For anyone, the Lord Jesus frees each of us to really live. He said, I came that you would have life and have it more abundantly. Today, we even can see the future through the vision that God gave John. John was banished to the Isle of Patmos. Even in the darkness of times, the God that we love gave him a revelation. John was a disciple. And how do I know? The Bible said, by this shall all men know that you are my disciples if you have love one for another. We must learn as children of God that nothing in this world, no matter how important we think it is more important than taking care of your family. Can I back it up? We're sure Paul the Apostle, he understood this also. When he wrote 1 Timothy 5 and 8, Paul said, but if any provide not for his own, and especially for those of his own house, he has denied the faith and is far worse than an infidel. So my brothers and sisters, there is a balance in life. There's a balance between serving God and taking care of your family. And we must search for that balance. The Bible tells us that John took Mary to his house and he cared for her. When I was reading that, I thought about, he never did ask Jesus no question, how she gonna be fed? Who gonna buy her clothes? How long am I supposed to keep her? He was glad to take Mary to his house and care for her. And for those that are young, I want to reach you today. You remember Gladys Knight and the Pip said, I would rather be in his world than to live without him in mine. Now that's love. My brothers and sisters, John knew that Jesus loved him and wanted to live in Jesus's world. He wanted to be in Jesus' world because he would rather be in Jesus' world than to live without Jesus in his world. Mary was willing to die to her own desires and submit to God's desire. And as a result, she was rewarded with a blessing greater than she could ever imagine. She gave up her son, Jesus, but she gained a savior. And I want you to know today that God wants to bless you as well. That's why he died, to bring good things into your life if we submit to his will. In closing, I want you to know that I believe in God, the Father Almighty. I believe that he is the maker of heaven and earth, but mostly I believe in his son, Jesus, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of a virgin Mary, but he had to suffer. Suffering under Pontius Pilate, crucified, dead, and buried. But thanks be to God, he got up. And because he got up one of these days, the psalmist said, his sky shall unfold, preparing for his entrance. The stars shall applaud him with thunders of praise. The sweet light in his eyes shall enhance those awaiting. And we shall behold him face to face. We shall behold him. Fight on, my sisters and brothers. Stay strong in the Lord. And when we behold him, oh, what a time, what a time. Behold him means we're going to see something that's remarkable and impressive. So when we see his face, all our troubles and trials will be over. And we thanks be unto God today for giving us the victory through his son, our savior, Jesus the Christ. May God bless you is my prayer.
Reverend Pearson, Beside Nella.
Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of all of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, for he is our strength and our redeemer. I'll be coming to you out of Matthew, the 27th chapter, verse 46. And it says in the ninth hour that Jesus cried out, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? I want to take for a subject this afternoon, forsaken but not forgotten. Forsaken but not forgotten. Have you ever been forsaken? Have you ever been abandoned? Have you ever been stood up? Have you ever felt like you were forgotten? We all have felt that some way or sometime in our life. Well, that's how Jesus felt the ninth hour when he cried out with a loud voice, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? No doubt Jesus felt forsaken when they placed the crown of thorns on his head. No doubt Jesus felt forsaken when they put the nails in his hands. No doubt Jesus felt forsaken when they put the nails in his feet. No doubt Jesus felt forsaken when they hung him high and stretched him wide and pierced him in his side. Jesus was forsaken for you and I. Jesus was about to fulfill his purpose for you and I. Jesus died for all of our sins so that we may have life and have life more abundantly. Oh, the agony that Jesus must have felt. Oh, the pain that Jesus must have felt. Oh, the hurt that Jesus must have felt. But we can see in this passage that when Jesus was going through, he knew who to call on. He called on God, our Father, that same God who says he will never leave us nor forsake us. Although Jesus was crucified, he died and was buried. But my Bible tells us that on the third day, he rose with all power in his hands. So when you're in your hour of despair, when you're in your hour of heartache and pain and feeling low, and especially now that what is going through with this COVID pandemic, most of us are walking around feeling as if we have been forsaken by God. But I'm here to let you know, you can feel forsaken, but you are not forgotten. You may feel like you've been forsaken, but just remember, you're not forgotten. That all that you have been through and all that you are going through right now, know that our Father has not forsaken you. For Jesus came and he came to give us life more abundantly. That only if those who believe in him, you will not perish, but you will have everlasting life. So I'm just here to remind you on this Good Friday, you might feel forsaken, but you are not forgotten. God bless you.
Amen. 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 Praise God. Amen. Reverend Latanya Ford. Reverend Ford.
Good afternoon. Can you hear me?
Yes, yes.
Truly God is good, and greetings to each of you, my brothers and my sisters, for expounding the word so wonderfully. Lord, hear our prayer, incline your ear to us, and grant us not only your peace, but grant us some understanding. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. On this, I'm thirsty, and found in the 19th chapter of the Gospel according to St. John, verse 28. The Bible says, knowing that all was now complete, and so that the scripture will be fulfilled. So Jesus said, I'm thirsty. It's an amazing thing God made when he made the body. It's amazing to think about now. Not only did he make us in his own likeness and in his own image, but in this particular text, it is God himself. Jesus himself has said that me and the Father are one. I'm in the Father in me. The word that John writes, even in the first chapter, he declares that in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God, and we know it. And yet we see God himself on Calvary's cross declaring that he was in need. He's declaring that something needs to happen for me to feel better than I'm feeling right now. Oh, but he would not accept really anything to help him with this pain, with the suffering. He understood that he had to go through this suffering. He understood that he had to go through this pain. He understood, in a sense, that this was a wilderness that he had to go through. He understood that this cross was the cross that he had to bear, not just for himself, but he had to bear it for us all. Hallelujah to the Lamb. And so here we see him now. Look at him on the cross, ripped off his clothing. Look at him, crown of thorns on his head. Look at him as the blood come streaming down in his face. He could see the blood coming down in his face. He could feel the nails as they had pierced his body, his hands and his feet. Look at him now as he even speak these words. And I imagine his voice was not as clear as it had been when he said, "Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God." His voice now seemed to be real raspy. His throat was dry and cracked, and it seemed as if his tongue was about to cleave to his mouth, and that his very throat was about to be closed up. And yet he says, "I'm thirsty." He showed, not only am I God, but I am human, and I have feelings. Amen. Just like you and me, we all have feelings. Yes, we don't understand a lot of things, but thanks be to God that no matter what it is we go through with, God is with us. And God was with his son, or shall I say God was with himself out there on Calvary's cross. It's kind of hard to imagine all of the pain and suffering and the shame and even the guilt that Jesus was bearing for you and for me. I preached yesterday and my subject was, are you guilty? Are you guilty of the body and blood of Jesus? And so here we are, guilty, guilty, guilty. And yet Jesus dies on the cross and he shows us his humanity by crying out, "I thirst. I want something. I want something to help quench this thirst of mine, perhaps." And yet when given something to help him with his thirst, he refused it. He gave him gall mixed with cheap wine and things. And upon tasting it, Jesus refused it. Gall, a very, very bitter substance. And here he crying out, "I thirst." And the only thing that is given to him is something bitter. Have you ever cried out for something and you know that people had it, but instead of doing the right thing, they gave you gall? "I thirst. I thirst. I feel like a human. And at the same time, I know that I'm going to God." And I don't care what you say in these hot days here in the state of Florida. Amen. You be outside for a while, sweating, becoming dehydrated, and it's nothing like a soothing drink. Amen. I don't care what the drink is. Well, I do care what the drink is, but a good drink of water. And if there's no water available, you'll drink a soda, you'll drink some coffee. But he wanted something to drink. He wanted something to soothe his throat, that he can say something to us again and bring some joy and some peace. "I thirst. I thirst after righteousness. I thirst after the loving Jesus. I thirst for those who were not saved. I thirst for those sinners. I thirst for people to come. I thirst for the church to do better. I thirst, oh, that the power of God will come in. I thirst. In other words, I want to be released. I want power to come in. I thirst. God bless you today, and God keep you, is our sincere prayer. And I do hope and pray that we remember when on the cross of Calvary, my Lord was crucified. And I want to know, do you remember him as he cries out to us, I thirst? Be encouraged. Stay safe. Stay blessed. In Jesus' name, amen. And we are listening out for the other two.
Amen. Amen, amen, amen. Reverend Knight?
Yes. Father, we stretch our hands to thee and no other help that we know. Thou withdrawest thyself from me, and whither shall I go? God, we ask you to bless this message, hide thee behind the cross. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. I'm going to use St. John 19 and 30 for our scripture. St. John 19 and 30. And when Jesus therefore had received the vinegar, he said, it is finished. And he bowed his head and gave up the ghost. Are you for a subject finished but not over? Finished but not over. The great lesson here to learn about the crucifixion of Jesus. Jesus in here we find on Calvary. He was on his way to the cross to die for us. They took him down, put him in a borrowed tomb. And here was a borrowed tomb because he wasn't, but stay there but 3 days. On the third day, he rose with all power in his hand, heaven and earth wrapped up in him. It was indeed was over for him, they thought. It was a dispensation coming in our lives, making us feel that it's over, even in our life. Sometime in my own life, we think things is over. But if we look unto Jesus, we know it's not over. You may have experiences in your life, devastation in your life, but better. And it might be death of a loved one, might be death of a friend, might be death of someone that you know for a long time, loss of a job, what you think is over. But if you just look unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of your faith, we must have faith in God. God will make things possible. The faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. Might be finished in some passages of your life, but it's not always over. But as we ponder on this message, we see here that sometime we in life, we go through all kind of life challenges and life disappointment. We go through sickness. I'm reminded of myself when I had an operation 3 years ago, and it was cancer. And I thought it was over. But I found out that I had a Lord. I had a healer that could heal my body. I found out that it was not over. I looked unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of my life. And I found out it looked like I was at the finishing line. But I found out it was not over because God had the last say so in my life. As we ponder here in this message, we know that Jesus was going, he was up on the cross. And he was telling them that it was finished. Finished what? Because it was finished for him. He didn't have to get down and cry mostly all night long, like we do sometimes. Sometimes we cry all night long and say, Lord, when is it going to be over? When is it going to be over? But Jesus have the last say so. If you was a child of God, you must look unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of your faith. Finish in your own eyes, but not finish with God. We must devote ourselves to God. We must trust in the Lord, as the songwriter say, I will trust in the Lord until I die. Later with devotion, we must find our faith in Jesus. We are promised. We must look unto him, that he know that he had promised that he would. He promised that he will prepare a place for us. And where he go, that we will go also. He will find ourselves, they say, weeping may endure for a night, but joy will come in the morning. I am reminded of disciples who had been fishing all night long and caught nothing. They washed their nets at night, and as they finished, they thought it was over, but it's what not over. The next morning, Jesus stepped into their situation. Have God ever stepped into your situation when you thought it was over? He stepped in right on time. He stepped into their situation and challenged them to cast their net on the right side for a draw. And they caught a multitude of fish. And one could only trust Jesus, knowing that which it is was finished in your life. God, you might thought it was finished in your life. God can give you a new day. Can actually be, he can draw. He say, draw me nearer, blessed Lord, to the cross where thou hast died. We have to realize that it's not over until God said it's over. Or you can say, oh Lord, help us to understand that when finished in our life, our faith in you can overbear it, take over for us. We have a new chapter in our life. We can go a little bit further. We know the one for Friday, Good Friday, there wouldn't be a Sunday morning. But we thank God for Friday, because Sunday morning is coming. Sunday morning is coming. And we know everything will be all right. We know there's a lot of time that Sunday morning need to come in our life. Then we can rise beyond our troubles. We can rise beyond our fears. We can rise beyond our disappointment and say, hallelujah, what a great day. We can see Jesus. We can see Jesus. We say, when we see Jesus, everything will be all right. When we see Jesus, all our problems will be over because of the Friday started on Friday at the cross when he said, it is finished. It is all over. He thought about us on the cross. They say it wasn't the nail that held him to the cross. It wasn't the nail that held him to the cross, but it was love that held him to the cross. Ain't you glad this afternoon that he stayed there? He stayed there for you and I, that we have the right to the tree of life. He stayed there because one of these days we're gonna have to, when we get through bearing our cross, we can say, it's finished. Amen. We can take our cross and put it and take it to Jesus and get our crown. No cross, no crown. Every day will be Sunday. They say Sabbath will have no name, have no end. It'll be over on that day. We can say hallelujah all day long. We can walk on the golden street. Amen. We can sing Zion songs. Say, how I got over. Great day is coming one day. Oh, what a day. It is finished. You say it's finished. It's all over. You don't have to do it anymore. It's all over. Finished. But not over. Sunday morning is on the way. God bless you. God keep you. Our prayer.
Reverend Ralph Williams.
Praise be to God. Just want to say that I've enjoyed all the speakers. They've done a marvelous job. And I thank God for this privilege that I can come and bring forth the seventh word. So the seventh word is coming from Luke chapter 23, verse 46. And when Jesus had cried with a loud voice, he said, Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit. And having said thus, he gave up the ghost. Just want to talk a few minutes from this title, Last Words to Live By. Last words to live by. Heavenly Father, I just ask you right now to take over, and you, Lord, just give insight. You give wisdom, and to thus saith the Lord. So our seventh word, Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit. See, in our scripture, Jesus cries out in a loud voice as a savior to the Father. Despite his pain, despite his agony, despite his suffering, Jesus is crying victoriously. It's a victorious cry for all to hear who he was talking to. For he was crying out for who he worshiped. He was crying out to who he prayed to. He was crying out to who he depended on. He was crying out to who he loved and who he would return to. He was making it known that he was crying out to his Father. And we too have to make it known that we cry out to our Father also. See, while hanging on the cross, Jesus made seven utterances. Seven is a number of completeness or perfection. Jesus was perfect. But the Bible says in 2 Corinthians 5:21, God made him who knew no sin to be sin on our behalf, so that in him we might become righteous of God. Seven is a number of rest for a finished work. Jesus already said it. It was just said, it is finished. He had finished his course. He had finished his mission. See, Jesus came to redeem, to save, and draw humanity unto himself. So just as the seventh day is a day of rest and satisfaction, so are the seven utterances of Christ, the Savior, to bring in to a place of rest. He had finished what he needed to do. His first saying was that of forgiveness. The second was that of salvation. The third word was that of affection. The fourth was that of anguish. The fifth was that of suffering. And the sixth was that of victory. See, now the seventh and final saying on this side of glory was, into your hands I commit my spirit. This was Jesus' prayer. This was the prayer that Jewish children were taught by their mother as they were about to go to sleep. See, I'm sure Mary, Jesus' mother, taught him that same prayer. This final prayer Jesus was saying was that to his father. This was a prophecy by David. And you can find this in Psalms 31 and 5. It was a prayer of deliverance. See, Jesus is telling us when we are facing darkness and despair, when we're facing the valley of the shadow of death, when we are facing the unknown, we should pray. See, as we go through this pandemic, the COVID-19, we need to pray. Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. When we're dealing with trials and tribulation of this world, Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. See, when you pray, okay, when you're going through pains and trouble, you push towards God, not push away from him. So when we have a loved one about to transition, or we are in our deathbed of affliction, we can say, Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. See, Jesus knew that death is the transition to eternal life. And we as believers know that we have eternal life because we know what John 3:16 said, that we will have eternal life if we believe in him. See, Jesus also tells us to place our life in God's hands. See, Jesus had to deal with many types of hands. He had to deal with hands that betrayed him, hands that persecuted him. He had to deal with hands that were placed on his head by a crown of thorns, with a crown of thorns. He had to deal with hands that nailed him to the cross. He had to deal with hands that pierced him in his side. But Jesus saying, there is no hands like my Father's hand. Not even all state has such hand. See, when we put our hands in the master's hand, the Father's hand means love. The Father's hand means security. The Father's hand means provision. The Father's hand means refuge. When you know about the Father's hand, you can say what Proverbs 3 and 5 and 6 said, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not unto your understanding, and in all your ways acknowledge him, and he will direct your path. So even in dying, Jesus knew who he could trust, but he knew his Father was going to resurrect him. See, he knew that that was trust, but he knew that his Father had his best interest at heart. The last thing Jesus was saying was, I surrender my spirit. I surrender myself back to you. Jesus was crying a prayer of submission. He entrusted his spirit back to his Father and yielded up his life. And that was such a scene that a Roman soldier saw it. And he even said he was overwhelmed. He was glorified that his Father had taken him in. So do you need such a savior as this? Do you need to glorify Lord? What do you need to glorify him? Do you need to get rid of pride, jealousy, anger, selfishness? God wants us to come back to him. And he said, Jesus finished his mission, but he left work for us to do. So I say to you, my brothers and sisters today, Father, into your hands, I commit my spirit. Father, into your hands, I commit my spirit. God bless you.
Amen.
On a hill far away stood an old rugged cross, the emblem of suffering and shame. And I love that old cross where the dearest and best for a world of lost sinners was slain. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and its chain. day for a crown.
Amen, amen, amen. We want to give an invitation now. Maybe there's someone that don't know that needs to be saved, that's going through, someone that has a problem and need Jesus. We've had seven words here today and letting you know that God has all strength, all power, and there's nothing too hard for him to do. Oh, we just thank God, and we give you the invitation now to receive the Lord Jesus Christ into your heart. Amen. All you have to say is, Lord, forgive me for all my sins, and believe that Jesus Christ died on the cross for you, and believe that he will save your soul, for he will never tell you no. Just give your heart to the Lord, and he will save you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Our words of thanks. We want to thank our speakers. We want to thank everyone that's on this video for the service. We just want to thank you. And anytime you need us, just give us a call. Amen. A benediction to God of Abraham, the God of Elijah, God of Jacob, God of Mary, God of Elizabeth. Have mercy, Lord. Lord, look down upon us and forgive us for all our sins and send your grace and mercy our way so that you can bless not only us, God, the speakers, God, but bless our family members, God, anyone that's in need, God. And Lord, give us the faith, God, to activate it and use it, God, all over the world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen, amen, amen. God bless you, and we will be calling you.